I recently joined SoftServe. I'm really happy about it, that there is such a big community here. So I wanted to share some of my knowledge. I really like to teach people things, especially that actually this also lets me learn things much better and much faster. So today's talk is about Lambda Architecture. Lambda Architecture, this is one of the first big data architectures that I got to know in my previous work. Lambda Architecture is an interesting merge of two data processing paradigms, batch processing and stream processing. And therefore, it was actually created or sort of introduced in 2011, so several years ago already, but it has been implemented in many environments, and it is worth to know it when working with the big data. So I hope that after this presentation, you will understand what are the components of this architecture, how to use it, what are pros and cons of it, so when to actually use it. So let's start. This architecture was initially introduced by Nathan Martz. In 2011, he actually posted a blog post where he was discussing how to beat the CAP theorem and how to make the data more accessible and more resistant to partitioning at the same time. And a year later on one of the conferences, he actually introduced it. There is a link here to this conference. So if you want to watch it, it's actually a very good talk when he explains what are the reasons behind this architecture and how he designed it. But the best resource for this architecture is actually his book, which he published in 2015 with James Warren by Manning Publications. It's called Big Data, and inside it has been really thoroughly explained what is Lambda architecture, how to use it. There are really many examples of various products and actually some code, how to implement this architecture. So if you want to get more information, there are multiple resources for this. This talk is introduction. So I will try to show you like the overview of this architecture, but I might not go very much in depth behind some of the decisions. So as I said, this is interesting merge of two data processing paradigms. One of them is batch processing. And this is probably the oldest way to actually process the data. Data rests somewhere, we take it, we process it, we call it often bounded data, so it has a start and the end, and basically that's it. It's actually interesting to describe this kind of processing in this like functional way. So basically what we have the outcome of this batch processing, batch view, is sort of a function of all the data that we gather for this batch. So we could describe it in this way. As everything, it has its pros and cons. So first of all, it's efficient, it's scalable. We have now very good tools that were created years ago to process batch efficiently. And it's horizontally scalable. So we, as we know, processors are not scaling that well, but we can just add more machines and process everything faster. And it's usually fairly easy to maintain because this process is, as I said, sort of functional. So we have input, we know what should be the output, and we can just troubleshoot it, monitor it, debug it if needed. If we have some problem, for example, a new version of our batch process does not maybe cause some errors, we can quickly just revert to the previous one and reprocess all the data. So this is really a lot of good things about it, but of course there are some disadvantages as well. First one, it can be expensive, both in time, because it takes time to process a lot of data, and resources, because we need a lot of memory, CPU. So as the data is growing, and we are in big data, so data is big, more or less growing all the time, this processing can be more and more expensive. Another con of this is a so-called latency and accuracy problem. And to be more specific, latency problem is basically about how long we have to wait for our data to be processed. So we have all the data, we want the answer to some question. Now we need some time to process this data, and after this time, this batch processing time, we will get the answer. But when we get the answer, we got the accuracy problem because our answer is already outdated, especially if data is coming all the time, and in current world and current IT, we have data being produced every single second, all the time. So if batch is taking like an hour, then we have an hour old information, and during this hour there might be new information coming into our system, which actually changes this answer. So to sort of counter this, what we came up with was a stream processing. And this is second paradigm. We basically have a data streaming continuously. So it's coming into our systems, and then it's processed piece by piece. So it's sort of like a log of events. So we take each event, evaluate it, do some actions based on this event, and then send it to some data store. Often this time of stream processing also needs, because this is an incremental process. So we basically need to have this data merged with what we already gathered. In a way, this real-time view, whatever we produce in this streaming process, is a function of both new data and what we have gathered until now, so the real-time view. The biggest pro on this streaming processes is low latency. So we can quickly get new data into our data systems. We can read them, update whatever we have, and user, whoever is using this output of our system, is able to gather new information really quickly and up to date. But there are, of course, some problems with this. First one, data in such systems usually is not stored, it's just processed. So if for some reason our process changes, we add fields, for example, to our, like a column to our table, or maybe we change the normalization process, which was normalizing some fields. The problem is that the data has been already out of the system, because it's like usually one time processing for each piece or each event. So it brings some problems with this reprocessing of the data. Another problem is that data might not arrive on time or in order. We can't really, most of the systems we have currently are at least one processing. They are not exactly one processing. So sometimes we get this data processed sooner or later. So we might actually process something out of order. And sometimes, of course, those systems, those events are not really coming ordered in time, because they might be coming from geographically distant systems, and then earlier events might arrive later. So there are multiple techniques to handle this. We have windows, we have watermarking. So we need to, we usually set some kind of deadline for the packets to come to, for those events to come. And sometimes happens that data is lost in the process. So something might arrive to the system. It's not arrived on time. Its window was already processed. So we just discard this data and the system is lacking this actually. The third problem of this is this incremental process. So we are adding new events to existing data. We are not really recomputing everything. We are just working on one event at a time or a window of events at a time, like a micro batch. But the problem with incremental processes is that they are not really resistant to human fault, because when we are writing software, we sometimes make mistakes. And when we make a mistake, maybe our counter, instead of once per event, will increase twice per event or something like this. And when this bug somehow makes it into production, shouldn't, but it actually happens from time to time, then the incremental process really is a problematic one, because it's really hard to sort of roll it back to the state before. We have to make some kind of backups, maybe recover those backups. It's complicated. It's not impossible. We have logs, for example, and we can use those logs to revert the data to previous state, but it takes time. So those processes have their own problems. And that's why when Marz was actually working on Lambda architecture, he put a lot of emphasis on this new architecture to be able to fix those problems. When this Lambda architecture was being designed, Marz formulated certain set of requirements for any big data system that he designs. First requirement was robustness and fault tolerance. So he wanted to make sure that if machines go down, system still works, behaves correctly despite machines, you know, going down randomly, which happens especially in big clusters. Then he wanted also human fault tolerance. So any data corruptions can be easily fixed if they are both due to incorrect code or maybe some other mistakes. Sometimes actually the data coming must be deleted. So, you know, that was one of the criteria that he wanted to fulfill with this new architecture. Second, one was low latency reads and updates. Here it's important to mention that this required latency depends really on use case. In some cases, this low latency is like an hour. In some cases, it's microseconds or milliseconds or generally real-time solution. So this system that we design needs to be adaptable, needs to have like a proper solution for any length of this time that is needed, this latency. Of course, it needs to be scalable. So using the technologies that currently are used for a horizontal scaling, which is best way to scale any system. And there is a set of other requirements which probably should be used for any kind of IT system, like generalization. So we want to be able to use it in wide range of applications. Extensibility, which means that we can have additional functionality. Ad hoc queries, so the data should be explorable by users. Minimal maintenance, debuggability, I can't say this word, sorry. So basically we need to be able to find bugs and easily fix the system in case of something goes wrong. And that's how this Lambda architecture actually came to be. First of all, Lambda Architecture assumes that we have some source of data, some stream of events that is being delivered to the system, and we need to process to react to this. This data is basically split into the two processing layers. One is batch layer, the one we all know, that will gather this information, this stream, save it as an immutable data set, and then every some time process it and send it to so-called serving layer. Then we have a speed layer. Speed layer is responsible for reacting to events with the required latency. So as the data is coming, we process it right away and also add it to the speed layer. And once we have all both batch layer and speed layer processing, then we have the serving layer, which is preparing a one comprehensive view that users can use. So whoever is consumer of our data, he's basically using serving layer to get a unified view in some scalable database that he can just use. Why it's called Lambda? Because that's like a question I had from the very beginning. Why it's Lambda? Why not something other? It's because it's sort of like a functional programming, or in general, Lambda is a symbol that we borrowed from math, from calculus. So this means that batch view, as already introduced, is like a function of all the data we have. Real-time view is a function of only new data, and real-time view that was gathered up until now. And whatever user is able to query is a function of both this batch view and real-time view. So that's where the name of Lambda architecture came. So let's look into the details of this Lambda architecture. As I said, it has those three layers. Batch layer is basically, first of all, storing all the data. This is really important function of the batch layer because this layer ensures our robustness and fault tolerance. We gather all the information of everything that comes to this stream of new data, we just store it. And then once, so every some time, let's say once every day, for example, or once every 12 hours, we compute everything and get the information that we want in a so-called batch view. This batch view is basically our comprehensible view of all the data, all the information we have. This data is accurate because it's based on this immutable data store of all the events. And in case, for example, that we introduce some bug to the compute process, some problem, or we need to add some field, we can easily reprocess it because this compute is running on all the data. At the same time, we have speed layer, and speed layer is gathering all the new data in this process stream, and then processing it and incrementing the real-time views. So real-time views are responsible only for the fresh new data. And in the serving layer, there is this merge between those two views. So batch view just presents a comprehensible view of everything that happened up until some point of time. And real-time view just adds a speed layer information of all the new events that showed since this batch was actually calculated. And once we have all this information merged, we can share it with users. To go back in much more into those details, first of all, there are what kind of technologies we can use. Mars actually, when he was creating this architecture, Hadoop was the best was created. And for data store, there was actually in his book quite a discussion about, you know, maybe using transactional, why not transactional basis? Why not SQL or no SQL basis? And he basically concluded that the best type of data store is HDFS. So at first it was Hadoop with HDFS to process everything. Spark showed up in 2014. So, you know, we are now using Spark, but still it's based on the same idea that we have some kind of file data store that is, why file data store or why distributed file system? Because data can be easily added to the files. Then data can be made immutable, so we can automatically make files immutable. No one can change them, no one can destroy the data. And then it's easily readable by those compute platforms like Hadoop and Spark. Of course, these days we have new coming technologies. We can use some kind of data warehousing systems like BigQuery or Redshift. I'm coming from AWS background, recently got introduced into Google Cloud. So I will be using those two as my source of new technologies. But of course, there are other interesting projects like, for example, for batch processing, we can use things that were until recently mostly connected to streaming, like Flink, Apache Beam, which is an open source implementation for cloud data flow. So basically, there are multiple ways to process this data. It's not always only Spark. There are some important details about batch layer. Well, first important discussion is about how to store the data. And the like most important assumption of this system is that data is immutable. So we are storing this data. First of all, we store it raw. As it comes from our event system, we store it as it comes, because basically any other type of manipulation that we later do, can we repeat it on the raw data that we are receiving? Of course, we could do some like basic cleanup, making sure that it adheres to some kind of schema. There is actually a proposal that we should use, for example, Apache Swift to make sure that the schema is properly applied to this raw data, but data should be as raw as possible. So that's the first rule. Second is that data is immutable. So once we save some information, we make sure that it will never be deleted from the system. If, for example, we have a Tom in our system and we gather information about him and he lives at some point of time in, let's say, San Francisco, then we store this information, and when Tom moves to Los Angeles, we also store this information, but we don't overwrite the information about San Francisco. That has why we do this. First of all, we can always roll back in case it happens that it was a mistake and it wasn't really the Tom or it wasn't Los Angeles. We can just delete this information or sort of roll it back. And then we know where Tom actually lives. Second is that we could use this information to derive like any point of time state of this database. So we can see, for example, where people were living in April, and then we can check where people are living in June. So this is really important too. So data is eternally true, which means that any stored data is basically, it's a fact about Tom. So we know that we have Tom. Tom was living somewhere, and we have information eternally that during this period of time, he was living in San Francisco. And last and not least is that data is atomic, so it's split into separate facts and timestamp. So each time we introduce something into our database, we timestamp it. This is important so we are able to first derive which is the current version of this information, so where Tom actually lives now, right now, and second, to be able to roll back or to move back in time if needed. So this fact-based model has several benefits. As I already stated, is queryable at any time in its history. Second, it's tolerant to human errors. So if some information was entered by mistake, we can roll back just this one single fact, this one information, and then we still keep the current data. So we are not really afraid of losing this older information or overwriting it. Third, it handles partial information. So basically the facts are being stored as they come. We don't really have to fill in all the facts. We of course treat those non-existing facts as null for any kind of further analysis, but we can fill it as it comes. We can add additional information. We don't have to put everything at once into this this database. And then we have this advantage of both normalized. It's more about the whole batch layer processing. We have this fact data can be, you probably all know what is the difference between normalized and denormalized forms of data. So the benefit of having things normalized is that data is atomic and we don't make like easy mistakes with this data that it's like differently written in different, you know, rows. But the normalized data has one big con, which is basically it requires a lot of processing power to be presented to users. We have to join the data between various tables. So the normalized form is actually useful for users who are presenting us with queries, because they can get this information faster. So if we store the fact tables in a normalized form, and then we process this data, we can create views for users of this like event information in a form that is specific to their queries and denormalized, so it can be quickly used by users with minimum processing power. Now, another question, another discussion when we are talking about batch processing is how we actually process the batches. We can use recomputation algorithms or we can use incremental algorithms. And difference between those is really simple. When we have recomputation algorithm, each time we get new data, we merge it with our data that we have up until now. And then based on this like whole information, we do the processing. And the like it has some problems, of course. It's expensive, because each time we do processing, we process every single piece of information, but it's fault tolerant and it's debuggable. So because we get the data, we have this functional way of processing. So we basically apply some function to this master data set and we get the output. So if this function that we apply is somehow corrupted because, for example, it was incorrectly written, there was a small mistake, we can just change it and then apply it again to this master dataset. On the other hand, we have incremental algorithms, which basically work only on the new dataset. So each time we get the new data, we process it, we add the outcome to the outcome of previous processing, and then this is our new updated view. This, of course, is efficient in both time and resources. It's much quicker, it's less resources, uses less resources, but it has lower fault tolerance, and in some cases it's really hard to fix. I personally had experienced such a failure or problem when we were processing listing data. So I was in my previous company, I was working in a company that was basically like a job board. So people were posting, like clients were posting job offerings, and people were, of course, trying to look through them. And we, for our data science group, we were gathering information about all the job postings that appeared in our system. So those lists, we called them listings. And the process was incremental because it was a huge database. It was the whole history was like 110 million of offers, and every single day we had to process it. So the process by itself was incremental. It was only processing each day new data. And therefore it took just like an hour or two to process everything. It was processing, was also normalizing, it was parsing it. There was a lot of processing done on this information. But then the problem appeared that we are actually missing some data, and some older, especially some older listings didn't really contain certain information. So there was a question, how do we fix it? Because we can fix code really easily, it's not a problem, but how we fix those updated views? And then the decision was, should we just run for all like processing for 2 years? But it's like 2 years is 700 something days. And each day was processing around, let's say, 2 hours. So it would be 1,400 hours of continual processing. So this was quickly scrapped because it wouldn't make really sense. And we basically had to create a new process that was doing recomputational work from the scratch to fix this one single problem. And that's why it's important to remember when you are working with batch processing, I know that this incremental is always very tempting to have because it's just working, you know, fast, and client is happy because, you know, it costs less basically. But you need to remember that from time to time mistakes will happen, and you need to have this recomputational algorithm in place to fix those mistakes, because if not, then it really will be a problem. You should probably start with, you know, the computation algorithm and then move into the incremental one, then the other way around. So that's, I think, all about the batch layer discussion. Now speed layer. Speed layer is basically all about streaming processing. And stream processing is these days used more and more, especially with data science teams creating new models and web pages being more and more interactive, because we want to give our clients what they want now. For example, in this example of the job offering board, when client creates an account and starts looking for some kind of job, they want to have like a tailored information as soon as possible. we can't present him each time he logs, like, let's say he logs in, browses, makes like two or three queries, and then decides that maybe he will come in 2 or 3 hours. And then in 2 or 3 hours, he logs into the website, and he was looking for a developer job, but first job on the list that we show him could be janitor, for example, or CEO. And then the question is, will this client be happy when he sees this? So what we are trying to do is making those web pages more and more interactive to the user's actions. And therefore, we want to, as soon as possible, to make recommendations. And those recommendations are based on users' actions. So we start streaming the data. And therefore, you know, it's important also to think about this streaming when we are designing the processes, especially this front client-facing processes. Technologies we use, I mean, there is a lot of technologies. I just could put just a few of them. You know, we have streaming things like Kafka or Kinesis in Amazon. We have a cloud PubSub, which is sort of like a limited Kafka. We have Amazon SQS, which is only for, you know, sending messages, but you can build whole streaming process based on those SQS queues. And for processing, we have also more and more choice. When Marc was creating his architecture, he was actually an author, a developer that was creating Apache Storm. So no wonder that he actually used it in his book as an example. But we have things like Apache Beam, we have Flink, we have Spark Streaming, and other. So there is more and more of those products that are able to process streams. There is one important discussion when we are talking about speed layer, and this is data retention. So how we actually combine speed layer and batch layer information, because it's actually not straightforward. Let's look at this example. We have some kind of process that is processing every single day with a batch job. Our data, okay? So we, on a day one, we start this system, it's brand new. It takes like, let's say 2 or 3 hours to process everything. And then we want to start serving this information to users. But when we were processing this data and we were processing only the data that arrived to the system before the day one, new data already appeared in our queue. So we have to start actually the speed layer as soon as we start also batch processing, exactly at the same time. Once batch processing is finished, then we present serve layer and the speed layer is continuing to work. So it gathers informations and then merges it into serve layer together with batch. Now, here comes the end of day one. So first thing, at midnight, day two, we start processing batch layer two, but we can't serve it yet. It takes 2 to 3 hours to process it. So what we do, we actually need to use serve layer and of course by extension speed layer of the day one through this processing time. And then at some point, we will have batch information for day two. But again, there is a problem because batch layer for day two will contain only information that was gathered before day two started. So exactly at the same time as batch layer for two was being processed, we already gather information for speed layer. So as you can see, we actually have two speed layers working at the same time. And this is really important to notice. Once we have batch layer finished for day two, we can turn off serve layer for day one and start serving serve layer for day two. At the same time, we are still working with a speed layer for day two, because this what actually serve layer two consists of, speed layer two and batch layer two. And again, exactly the same happens on day three. So we keep serving day two, we start calculating batch for day three, and then at some point we also merge it with speed layer from day three, and then we serve it as serve for day three. So it's not like straightforward. As you can see, we actually need to be able to somehow gather information for this, like two separate speed layers at some point, because they overlap. So that's actually the most important part about speed layer. And of course, then we have serving layer, and technologies here are again multiple, and I'm not gonna delve much into it. Many times it's actually REST API that is serving this information to user. And it's actually pretty simple, because we have some kind of service behind this REST API that can check batch view and can check real-time view. But there are other solutions. We can load this data into Cassandra database. HBase is often used for this. Druid was actually designed for this fast, you know, data updates. And it's, as far as I gathered, for example, used by Netflix. In Lambda Architecture, they have there. And we could use other databases. There are probably too many. We can even stream into BigQuery. So, you know, there are multiple possible solutions here. And that's pretty much it. On a theoretical level, that's how Lambda Architecture works. So we have, again, new stream processing. We have immutable data store, which is computed into batch views every some time. And we have also separate processing stream, which is incrementing real-time views. And both batch view and real-time view are used, merged, and served to the user. I decided also at the end of this, because this would be purely theoretical, so I wanted also to show you some kind of use case for this. My use case for, I mean, there are multiple YouTube videos you can actually watch and see what people are using. And at the end of this presentation, I actually added some links to material I used or seen about this Lambda architecture. This one is based on my own experience. So basically, it started very simple. We had those listings, those job offerings that we were getting from our transactional system each and every day. And then we were constructing a listings database that was stored. It was Amazon, so it was stored on S3 and served through the Hive to our users, to data science team. They used usually Spark. Or PySpark to browse it, to explore it, and to find some kind of new use cases for their products. So that's how it started. But at some point, as I said, our websites got more and more interactive, and we wanted to make sure that the data is visible to some processes as they come. So we got we actually plugged in into our transactional systems. We got the events that were like pre-processed, and then once we had like a common schema, they were sent to Amazon SQS, and from there it started to be like stream processing. So the stream processing, it was a bit complicated because we had to normalize, we had to download the content of the listing from somewhere. Then we had to normalize it, we had to rank it, and there were multiple processes and some models used, data science models used in this process. So it took some time. We used a technical database, NoSQL. In this case, it was Amazon DynamoDB, which was used as a technical data store for this information. This was our speed layer, basically. And once we had this information, we've sent it to Elasticsearch, and then this was served by a REST API to our users. They could, of course, use Elasticsearch directly, but in many use cases, it was easier just to present them with a simple, it was actually a Spring packed in Docker. So this was also scalable solution for users. We could scale it horizontally if needed. And those processes, as you can see, they are separate. And that's how it was for quite some time. The problem with this was that on one hand, we had this real-time system that was processing everything and putting it into for users, but we didn't have some easy way to move it into this Hive from Elastic. And actually, the schema was slightly different. And we, at some point, decided that we have two different processes to take care of. We want to have just one database that we want to take care of. So we decided to design this. That's when we actually met this Lambda architecture, and we decided to model it around this architecture. So first of all, we added this event store. This event store gathered information about, you know, events. So what kind of listings showed up in our system. Then we had to modify this listing batch process, which wasn't using the external database in the same way. It was first using this event data store to calculate what we actually need to get from this raw data set. And then we, of course, were still using this Hive for our users, but then we also added a process that was basically from time to time overwriting this Elasticsearch database with newest versions of all the listings. This way we could, for example, because listing batch process, one of the things it was doing was from time to time, once a month, it was renormalizing all the listings. Because for first of all, some listings, they don't change per se, but we change the way we normalize the data. We change the way we parse the data. So this way we could renormalize listings that were processed previously by the stream processing, because they were never ever changed again, like inside those listings. They were not reprocessed by the stream, but we were making sure that this information is being like introduced, this new normalization was being introduced into this Elasticsearch. I didn't actually see the finished product, so I know that there are some problems to be solved. For example, how this Amazon database is reacting to Elasticsearch when it's being overwritten. So we basically had to, the idea was we had to like A and B Elasticsearches. And because you know, I joined here SoftServe, and I'm happy for this. But this is one of examples of how this kind of architecture grows and how this architecture can be used in processing. What is the like pros of this architecture? Once again, I want to say that the biggest probably three are human fault tolerance, low latency, and scalability. Scalability, of course, is the derivative of technologies we use, but human fault tolerance means is actually due to this architecture. So we use this immutable data set that we have and this recomputational algorithm, which can correct quickly any mistakes that can be introduced by humans. Low latency is thanks to speed layer. So we have this accurate part from the batch layer, and we have the speed part, this fast part due to this speed layer. Of course, this has also some cons, and you need to remember about them. It's not like all of just roses and unicorns. First of all, at the very beginning of this architecture, at creation, the problem was it was two technology stacks. One was for batch and one was for streaming. This actually is sort of fixed these days because we have technologies. For example, Spark has Spark Streaming. So if we create code for batch processing in Spark, we can use this code for Spark Streaming. We can use Beam, we can use Flink for both batch processing and for streaming. So this still needs to be taken into account, but overall, we could reduce this disadvantage of this architecture by taking good care about choosing the proper technology. Second problem is immutable dataset that is constantly growing. So from the very start, you start gathering this data and it's growing and growing. And this means that each recomputation will be more and more expensive. And you need to take this into account. So maybe it's a good idea to think about additional incremental batch processing at some point. And then recomputing batch, okay, so I already said this is more and more expensive. Possible solutions, as I said, use the same tech stack, incremental batch computations. And of course, in many use cases, you can use different architectures. So maybe Lambda is not always the best architecture around. For example, one of the first was Kappa architecture, which is basically pure stream that also gathers immutable data set. So if it needs to recompute something, it can just use this immutable data set to put it back into stream, and then we can just reprocess everything if needed. But we have one technology stack. So I think that's all. I will also, in the presentation, there is also a lot of links, so you can see there are some articles. There is a good article I found on my Medium about how to use Spark and Spark Streaming to set the Lambda architecture. And this article actually has some code, so examples. It's from, I think, from Walmart Tech Big Data department. There are some good theoretical and some good practical YouTube videos. And of course, there is this book, Big Data, from the author of this architecture. So it's really a good read for anyone who wants to get some good base of information about big data overall, because it says a lot about various about stream processing, about this speed layer or streaming processing, and what we need to watch out for when we are designing such systems. So I recommend it very much. And I think that's it for the presentation.